Well, hey there, podpreneurs. Welcome to another bonus episode. Today, I'm lucky to chat with Matthew Weiss, and I'm so happy he agreed to stop by today and talk with us. Matthew Weiss is an incredibly talented engineer and is the recordist and mixer for singer-songwriter-producer Akon. Matthew was the recordist on Grammy-nominated and Spellman Award-winning albums, and he is also the primary content provider for the Pro Audio Files. If this is your first time hearing about Matthew, you gotta check out proaudiofiles.com. It's packed full of educational content specializing in audio and music production. Matthew also has hundreds of videos available on YouTube that are incredibly informative and helpful. He really knows his stuff. Not only does he have an incredible ear, years of production experience, and a vast degree of knowledge, but he also happens to be wonderfully articulate and comprehensible. In addition to his work as an audio engineer, he's also had significant experience in the world of education. He taught as a guest instructor at Cornell University, Sunny Fredonia, Slate's Digital Audio Legends, Pro Studio Live, and Produce Like a Pro. I'm so excited to chat with Matthew all about podcasting for newcomers and those looking to improve their podcasts. We'll talk about microphones, preamps, interfaces, DAWs, compression, and a bit more. This is definitely an interview you want to take some notes from. Well, okay, let's get to it. Hey, Matthew, how's it going?
Everything is good. How are you?
I'm doing good. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, my pleasure. Let's talk about audio quality and get these podcasts sounding good.
All right, let's do it. So this is season one for beginners, so I really wanted to pick your brain about the equipment that people are going to need to get going on their podcast, or if they want to upgrade to make their podcast better. So I was hoping we could start with microphones. So I wanted to know if you had any recommendations for podcast or broadcast style microphones. Is there any difference between maybe a male voice and a female voice? What are your thoughts on microphones?
So there's a couple of levels of consideration when we're talking about microphones. The first is, you know, the actual quality of the mic itself. The second one is the quality relative to the vocalist, which is what you're saying, male or female. And it's even a little more nuanced than that. And then the third is the law of diminishing returns, which is how deep down the rabbit hole do you really want or need to go? So, I mean, I recommend getting the best microphone that you can if audio quality is really your only concern. That said, in the microphone world right now, things are extremely competitive. I've been hooked up with a company named Jay-Z Microphones. They sell microphones for around $1,000 that compete with any microphone 3,000 or greater. Our ultimate goal is clarity of the voice, right? So we don't have to compete with a music bed most of the time. We're not competing with self-noise, even in the cheapest microphones. So, you know, I don't think that you have to go super expensive to get a good podcast recording. Middle of the pack, I recommend the Jay-Z microphones. Cheaper end, I'm a fan of Audio Technica. More expensive end than, you know, getting into like the Neumanns and things like that. Male or female, again, that's how deep down the rabbit hole you want to go. It's more like bright versus bassy. And so if you have a bassy voice, you generally want a brighter microphone.
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, a lot of times when people are first looking into microphones, they might be bewildered by what's the difference between a dynamic and a condenser microphone. Why might somebody want a dynamic microphone versus a condenser?
There's a couple reasons why a dynamic microphone is going to be a better choice. One being that if you're using a room that is not set up acoustically for recording, or is at least controlled to a certain degree. Like I can see that your room has some acoustic baffling going on to control some of the reflections and things like that. So a condenser is going to act better in a treated space. A dynamic is going to reject more of the side information. It's only going to pick up what's directly in front. And so it rejects a little bit more of the room interaction. The other reason why dynamics are good is because the proximity effect is a little bit more pleasing than a cardioid condenser, RE20s and SM7s in particular. You can get pretty close to those and they will have bass buildup, but it's a little bit more even sounding than if you're to get right up close to a cardioid condenser.
Okay, so if somebody's in a sound controlled room, not a very noisy environment, Would you usually always recommend a condenser over a dynamic?
Ultimately, what's going to give you a more natural and full representation of a sound is going to be a condenser microphone the vast majority of the time, particularly with voices. So if you want to catch a little bit of the air and space, you want to catch the nuance of the mouth noises and formants and things like that that are up in the higher register, you're just going to get a better response from the condenser and better transient response as well, which will help with the clarity of things. So, you know, dynamics always sound a little bit kind of like they're sort of like muffled slightly, whereas condensers sound a little bit more open and honest.
Okay, cool. Well, then I think that's enough about microphones. One thing I think is really confusing to a newcomer to audio production is preamps. Like, what is a preamp? Why is a preamp important? What does it do? You know, and obviously preamps come built into most interfaces. And so what are you looking for when you're looking for a preamp? And what are your thoughts on preamps?
How technical should I get on this? Okay, so in order for your sound to become a digital sound and get recorded into a computer, you need a conversion system. And those converters need a certain amount of amplitude of signal in order to properly read what's coming into them. Unfortunately, microphones are very, very low output sources. They are called mic level sources for obvious reasons, and they are low. So a preamplifier is something that amplifies the signal before getting to the digital audio conversion. So it is an amplifier in front of that step. The preamplifier is going to take that microphone level signal and turn it into what's called a line level signal. Now, in order to do this, you have to put in some kind of a gain stage, and the quality of that gain stage will affect the quality of the signal coming out the other end. So a preamp is an integral part of this entire process. It is literally recreating the sound based on the sound that is coming into it. And so if your preamp is a dud, you will get something that does not sound good at all. And if your preamp is great, even a not so great microphone will usually sound pretty good going through a really good preamp.
Yeah. And then moving from preamps into audio interfaces, you know, I said that the audio, a lot of audio interfaces come with preamps. How do you go about selecting an interface that has a good preamp? Is it by brand name, or how do you know if it has a good preamp in it? And then also, what are your thoughts about maybe getting external preamps and then taking the line level from those external preamps and putting them into your interface?
So all interfaces, all prosumer level interfaces generally will have a preamp chip built into the front end, and they're almost always all bad. I've never heard one where I've been like, that sounds great. There's some where it sounds okay. The Apogee Duet sounds okay. The M-Box 3 sounds okay. And Slate Digital just put out a interface with a preamp. And I know from the quality of the build and having discussed with Steven what's going in there, and it's a good quality chip. So I imagine it would sound pretty good. But outside of those, I mean, and those are going to be the interface combos. It's just, it's only one little op amp. And to have a really sustainable quality power going into a signal, you really need a designated power source. You will need a feedback circuit of some sort to kind of control what's going on. And so there's just not enough real estate in an interface to traditionally have a decent preamp.
Okay.
For externals, I do think that that's probably the way to go. And it doesn't have to be a great external preamp. Pretty much anything in the $200 to $400 category is probably going to be a little better than what's built into the interface. The other side of the interface is the analog to digital conversion, or digital analog conversion. Is there a variety of quality? Yeah, the Apollo is maybe a little bit better than some of the other ones. The M-Box, again, is pretty decent. The Apogee, again, is pretty decent. But they're all sort of within the same realm of quality overall.
Okay. Then the other thing that I think people are concerned with is DAWs or DAWs, and if it is necessary for them to spend money on Pro Tools, or if they can get away using some of the free versions like Audacity or GarageBand. What are your thoughts on how the free versions compare to the professional versions?
When it comes to doing strictly speech recording, you don't really need to differentiate between your digital audio workstations too much. There's no real reason to go up to something like Pro Tools or Cubase or anything like that. GarageBand is fine. And I know that some people might get a little precious about that kind of stuff, but actually it is. And I mean, I've cut records for platinum artists in GarageBand, it's not my preference because I don't like the editing functions as much, and the way that it handles processing is a little bit more encumbered than something like Pro Tools. But, you know, when you're doing a podcast, you're not really dealing with more than a couple tracks of audio. So for that, actually, GarageBand is fine. I'm not familiar with Audacity, but I reckon that it's fine too. The reason why it works out is because the brunt of your sound quality is going to come from your signal processing, not from the DAW itself. So with most of these open architecture type things, you have either AU format or VST format, where the quality of the processors are the same across the board, regardless of what DAW you're using.
Oh, so that's very interesting. I think that is a hopeful thing for people on a budget, and definitely probably also explains why Audacity and GarageBand are so useful. And that brings me to the final things I wanted to talk about, was just compression versus limiting, and why compression is so important, and maybe some concerns and uses that you could see a podcaster having with compression.
Compression is a confusing topic, I think. And I think that's why people struggle with it. But basically, compression is something that takes the loudest parts of a signal and turns them down to make them a little bit more even with the quieter parts of the signal. In other words, it compresses the range of the audio, hence the word compressor. So a limiter is a type of compressor. However, it's a type of compressor that's designed specifically to act over very, very short periods of time. And it's mainly meant for controlling things that have sudden quick bursts of energy, like if I accidentally dropped my computer or something like that, or if I leaned in, or if I just suddenly went, really loud. You know, a limiter would be good to catch that kind of stuff. In the world of speech processing, I don't recommend using too much limiting. It's not really necessary. The better solution is to have a gentle but affected range of compression.
Aha, gotcha. So I want to talk to you about EQ, but we can talk more about EQ over on iTunes on the full version of this episode. But here on the YouTube, I wanted to just ask you, I know that you have some awesome tutorial videos about compression and EQ. I was wondering if you could tell us about that.
So I have two for sale tutorials. One is called Mixing with Compression. One is called Mixing with EQ. Now, for podcasters, I think mixing with compression is way too music oriented to be really beneficial. They could probably watch about a quarter of that and get everything that they need to know. So I'm not recommending that one, but mixing with EQ, really, EQ is the same idea across the board. And so that one, it's, while there is music content as the examples, I think would be useful for learning EQ for podcast applications as well.
Okay, and where can we find this?
The for sale landing page is mixingwitheq.com.
Okay, great. Because that's something, like I said, the EQ, but at the same time, it seems very overwhelming. But I think once you get into it, once they watch your video, once they do a little more research into it, they'll find that it's not as bewildering as it seems.
No, the trick is knowing what to listen for. And once you understand what to listen for, it's not that tough.
Yeah, I think that's great. And, you know, I just, again, want to thank you so much for stopping by and helping out these little podskinators get better at podcasting, and really appreciate it. And how can we find you on YouTube and in other places?
Okay, so easiest places are either going directly to theproaudiophiles.com, which is where I do a lot of educational content. Or if you're on YouTube, you can just type in The Pro Audio Files and it'll come up. And there's hundreds of videos depending on what you're looking for. So plenty of stuff.
All right. Well, I really appreciate you coming by today. And thanks so much.
Hey, thanks for having me, Steven. The Pod Show.